Hello, I'm Dr. Hazel Lowe. I'm a plasma physicist working on fusion plasma diagnostics at Tokamak Energy in the UK. It's Friday the 8th of April 2022, and this is your fusion news update. Stories today include: 1. HB11 Energy achieves world first hydrogen fusion milestone with a laser, plans $20 million Series A. 2. Blue Origin Vets unveil startup seeking small solution to massive challenge of fusion energy. 3. Atomic Energy Authority aims for diversity and inclusion with fusion energy employment scheme. 4. Stellarator plasma oscillations resemble struggle between predator and prey. And I also have a couple of bonus items for you at the end. 1. HB11 Energy achieves world first hydrogen fusion milestone with a laser, plans $20 million Series A. This week, Sydney-based startup and Fusion Industry Association member, HB11, has hit the news off the back of recent experimental results published in the scientific journal Applied Sciences. Those of you that watched the last episode of Fusion News will have seen Sid reporting on German company Marvel Fusion, which is pursuing a similar laser-driven fusion scheme. Back in 2021, we reported on the US National Ignition Facility's landmark results using an array of 192 high-powered lasers to generate 1.9 megajoules of fusion energy. Well, HB11 Energy is taking a different approach. Instead of combining the hydrogen isotopes, deuterium and tritium, to produce energetic neutrons, HB11 Energy's recent publication demonstrates that they were able to generate fusion reactions between hydrogen and boron. Before building laser diagnostics for tokamak plasmas, I worked on petawatt-class laser plasma experiments, so it's great to see these results relating to a laser-driven fusion scheme. A petawatt is 10 to the power of 15 watts. So a petawatt laser is 10 million million times more powerful than a standard light bulb. HB11 Energy used the LFX petawatt laser at Osaka University in Japan to irradiate a boron nitride target for just a fraction of a second, transferring some of the laser energy to the hydrogen ions inside the target. The hydrogen then collided with the boron, producing energetic alpha particles. According to the article, 140 billion alpha particles were produced. To put that in context, when you add one proton to one boron nucleus, the product is 3 alpha particles. So this result implies that a large number of fusion reactions occurred. But the efficiency of the conversion from laser energy to alpha particle energy was only 0.005%, so they're far from generating energy gain. Dr. Daniele Margarone, a laser acceleration physicist at the Queen's University Belfast, who collaborated with HB11 Energy on this experiment, said these results are a big step forward, not a breakthrough. They went on to explain that, for the first time, a large amount of proton-boron fusion reactions were demonstrated using a short-pulse laser that can be potentially scaled up at large laser fusion facilities. Founder and managing director of HB11 Energy, Dr. Warren McKenzie, said, "Our unique approach to large-scale clean energy generation uses an aneutronic fusion reaction between hydrogen and boron 11 that doesn't use any radioactive fuels or generate uncontrollable radioactive waste. Achieving this on a large scale will be a game changer. But to do this locally, we need significant investment in our sovereign capability, including having a petawatt laser in Australia." 2. Blue Origin Vets unveil startup seeking small solution to the massive challenge of fusion energy. Another Fusion Industry Association member, Avalanche Energy, is developing an unconventional compact fusion reactor device the size of a medium suitcase that could be used to power aeroplanes, ships or cars. Avalanche Energy launched in 2018 in Seattle, USA, and has so far raised $5 million. By adapting established technology used in devices such as mass spectrometers, Avalanche Energy has built a prototype fusion device. This device uses electrostatic fields to trap high-speed deuterium ions orbiting around a negatively charged cathode. The ions can be trapped for a relatively long time, allowing periodic collisions, which the team claims has resulted in the production of high-energy neutrons. The next step towards an ultimate fusion reactor device, that they've named the Orbitron, is to add electromagnets to confine the electrons, which the team hopes will boost the fields inside the device and lead to increased ion densities, leading to more fusion reactions and a higher energy output. The company's founders both come from space company Blue Origin, and credit the space sector for inspiring fusion researchers to break out and form small, dynamic, privately funded companies, rather than sticking with huge national or international government-funded labs. Chief Operating Officer Brian Riordan reflects that. I think that our timing was just perfect for that cusp of people saying, I think we can really do wild, tough things in private industry faster and without the bureaucracy red tape, and we're willing to put money down on it. 3. Atomic Energy Authority aims for diversity and inclusion with fusion energy employment scheme. Regular viewers of the channel will be familiar with various fusion projects under the umbrella of the UK Atomic Energy Authority, UKAEA, including the Joint European Torus Jet, which recently achieved a fusion energy yield of 59 megajoules, and the spherical tokamak mast, both of which are currently operating in the UK. You may also remember us reporting on the spherical tokamak for energy production, which the UK government is developing as a proof of concept reactor that can deliver fusion energy to the grid and is due to be constructed by 2024. To support these projects over the next 4 years, UKAEA will be creating over 100 new roles worth £9.5 million. In order to fulfil their commitment to improving social and economic inequality, in addition to providing a fast and flexible approach to recruitment, they've partnered with a selection of British companies with a proven track record of being committed to equality, diversity and inclusion, whose employees will have the opportunity to be redeployed to work at UKAEA. Science Minister George Freeman said, UK fusion energy breakthroughs at Culham have shown the potential of fusion energy, not just to provide instant zero emissions clean energy at the flick of a switch, but also to attract big investment to create new companies and high quality jobs for thousands of people in fusion energy around the country. This new fusion jobs framework by the UK Atomic Energy Authority will boost both the UK economy and help tackle social and economic inequality by creating jobs for all parts of the UK. 4. Stellarator plasma oscillations resemble struggle between predator and prey. You might have heard us talk before about a type of magnetic confinement fusion device called a stellarator, which gets its name from its potential to harvest the fusion process that fuels the stars. Just like a tokamak, a stellarator is a hollow metal vessel surrounded by strong electromagnets that are used to contain the plasma fuel inside. A stellarator has a more complex magnetic coil structure than a toroidal or spherical tokamak, which allows the plasma to be contained for longer. This increases the likelihood of fusion occurring, which is a product of plasma temperature, density, and the confinement time. As in a tokamak, the plasma inside a stellarator creates waste heat that needs to be removed from the device without causing damage to the internal walls, in the same way that a car engine needs an exhaust. This is done in part of the device called the diverter, but it's not trivial to dump the heat, even in materials with high thermal resistance. Researchers led by Tatsuya Kobayashi at Japan's National Institute for Fusion Science have recently tested out a new method for keeping the plasma away from the diverter by adding extra magnet coils to a stellarator called the Large Helical Device. Their aim was to magnetically isolate the plasma from the diverter surface. However, modifying the field structure caused the plasma to detach and then collide with the diverter at a rate of 40 times per second, which the researchers compared to the cyclical relationship between the size of predator and prey populations in nature. The next challenge for them is to slow down this oscillation and keep the plasma away from the diverter for longer periods of time. And now for the bonus items. Earth.org has a great article explaining the basics of fusion and going into why it's a clean, safe, sustainable source of energy, while BBC Science Focus has a series of photos showing construction of the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, ITER. And journalist Mike Brown of Inverse.com takes a whistle-stop tour around the big fusion project and speculates about when we will achieve fusion energy, a holy grail of clean power. That's all for fusion news this week. Please subscribe for more fusion news and check out the links in the description if you want further information. And thanks for watching.